Good afternoon, everyone. I hope you hear us well. So I'm Inno in Tumwebaze with my colleague Bob, and we shall basically be helping in moderating this session that looks at hygiene, safety, and COVID-19. We shall be having three presentations, and always we shall always be having your comments and questions come in to each presenter after their presentation has been showed. So like we have put a text in the chat, we request that we be using the chat for the questions. And also if you want to introduce yourselves. And then always after running a presenter's presentation, then we shall be having the presenter join the boardroom to respond to any comments towards their presentations. So without further ado, we can go to the first presentation. And this is from Surendra, looking at lessons learned from monitoring of COVID-19 response in Nepal.
Dear all, greetings from Kathmandu, Nepal. In this high-level forum of professionals and practitioners, I'm going to present a paper on behalf of my colleagues, Michael, Alisha, Annapurna, and Tamiz, who are the co-authors for preparing this paper. And the paper is about lesson learned from monitoring of COVID-19 response in Nepal. Effectiveness and timeliness on availability of monitoring data is the key for any emergency programming. In line with the globally and nationally agreed indicators for UNICEF WASP program to respond to the COVID pandemic, UNICEF Nepal Country Office developed a simple yet effective monitoring framework to monitor the WASP interventions related to COVID response. The main objective of the monitoring framework are to facilitate the decision making by providing real-time data, for identifying the needs and carry out effective advocacy and resource mobilization, and to be transparent to the donors and partners. The monitoring framework is developed in Excel-based file in collaboration with the government and other WASP partners in the country. The key indicators of UNICEF WASP programs, as mentioned in this slide, the number of people engaged and reached with accessible information on COVID, number of people reached with critical WASP supplies and services, and number of healthcare facilities supported with IPC, infection prevention and control supplies and services. All those data are collected in the monitoring frame that is discussed here. Those data are disaggregated by geographical locations, type of service and type of support provided, and demography of the beneficiaries. After the development of the frame, it was shared with the partners, just share with the individuals who are responsible for implementation of the activities. As the COVID situation was changing, the interventions types were also adapted accordingly. It was not always possible to count the beneficiaries exactly. Therefore, some assumptions have to be made. Based on the learning, some of the assumptions that were made to calculate the number of people assisted by counting the number of supplies provided. Like, we counted the number of soaps or hygiene kits or water purifier tablets or number of water points or latrines installed. And then we calculated the people assisted by those supplies or services. You can see in the box some multiplication factor or some coefficient were used to calculate the beneficiaries. After the monitoring framework was completed, the field and data were collected in an agreed timeline and frequency. The data were compiled and presented in the table as shown here. You can see here the input table and the output table, where you provide inputs and then you calculate the output. A monthly result on the beneficiaries against the three indicators, as I mentioned in the first slide, like in different settings, in quarantine sites, isolation centers, or holding points, or schools, were made available. As a result, the information collected and compiled in the monitoring frame were further used for different purposes, like producing the updates, producing the situation reports, sharing with the partners or government, and to inform the sector as a whole on real-time monitoring data. One of the key learning of this exercise, the whole exercise of monitoring frame, was increased efficiency. There was a major lesson learned. A harmonized monitoring frame through wide consultation with the partners delivered a good result in the ground. And having one tool which is harmonized for all the partners, for all the activities, and in a very, very simple format which is used, which could be used by the partners of different capacity, became a real learning and helped a lot in maintaining the data in real-time basis, inform the sector, generate the resource, and do the effective COVID response in Nepal. There are a few references that were used to draft the paper. With this, I'd like to thank you all, and if you have any questions and time permits, we can discuss further. Thank you very much.
Thank you for that good presentation. So we shall be moving you to the presenter room, and all questions at this moment are welcome for our presenter. Bob will help in moderating the discussion part.
We have our first question from Rod. This is an interesting presentation. You say you made a number of assumptions whilst collecting the data. How reliable are the data?
Do you hear me?
Yes, we hear you, Surendra.
Okay, thank you very much, Rod, for that good question. In fact, I said we made some assumption to calculate the beneficiary from the number of supply we provided or number of services that we provided to the community. Meaning, if we provided one hygiene kit, for example, then one hygiene kit may serve to a certain number of people. So for that case only, we had to make some assumption. In general, WASH emergency program, one hygiene kit, here in my example, is supposed to be used by one family, meaning a family of four or five, right? In general situation, it is number of hygiene kit multiplied by five. But in COVID situation, it is a little different because the family are quarantined, they are living separately, maybe one person or two person of a family is using that particular hygiene kit. And in the context of quarantine site or in the context of holding center, we call here in Nepal, like where people are isolated, then depending on the context where we provided those supplies or services, we had to come up with the end calculation for the beneficiary. This is what I mean to say. Hope I made you clear, Rod. Thank you.
Surendra, could you describe a little further the examples of possibly how the information was harmonizing between your different respondents?
Yeah, again, a very good question. In emergency situation like this in COVID and like in other emergencies, there are a lot of partners who provide emergency response. And the way that they do their own monitoring and the way that they have their own internal monitoring system, it varies, and we all know. But in this particular context, and also being UNICEF as a focal person, we had an advantage that we are also a cluster lead. So then we put this method and this way of doing collecting the information, compiling it to all the sector partners. And all the sector partners were briefed. And we also received feedback from them. So in fact, it was a kind of co-creation on agreeing on the frame and also on agreeing on the procedures, the methods. So this is how it was done, but definitely there were challenges in terms of getting the information from all the responders and compiling it together, because the information comes from a very remote village in one district, and then it comes to national level. But it was communicated to all the partners, and it was agreed together to use the same methodology. So in fact, it happened to be very, very effective. And it's starting from the beginning, early 2020 to until now, we are using the same framework, and we have received a lot of appreciation from the partners and also from the government on this particular way of doing collecting data and provide, like, analyzing it and disseminating. Thank you.
Thank you.
So if we don't have any other questions, we shall now move on to the next presentation. But again, at the end of the session, we shall again have all our presenters together. And in case new questions will be coming up, then we shall be responding again on a bigger kind of picture. Thank you very much, Surendra, again, for that interesting presentation. And we look forward to learn more from the other coming presentations.
Thank you very much.
Hi, everyone. I am Wigke. I'm going to present our research with Naomi Francis about the impact of COVID-19 on women's access to water, sanitation, and hygiene in Indonesia fishing village. This research funded by the Australia-Indonesia Center and PAIR, and also collaboration between Universitas Gajah Mada, or UGM in Indonesia, and Monash University in Australia, and also part of the collaboration with women coastal communities, part of KNTI, Indonesian Union Fishermen, Traditional Fishermen. Okay, Naomi, your turn.
Hi, everyone. So a bit of the background to this research were some facts we know already about WASH COVID-19 and the role of women. So we know that in places where access to WASH is poor, women and other disadvantaged groups are disproportionately affected. And we also knew that women globally are disproportionately affected by the impacts of the COVID-19 pandemic. And we also knew that hygiene is a key COVID-19 prevention strategy, particularly in places where social distancing and stay-at-home measures are not possible, which is partly the case in fishing villages in Indonesia. And so we wanted to look in the context of Tambak Lorok, which is the largest fishing urban village in Semarang City, which is on the north coast of central Java in Indonesia. So the UGM team already had a relationship with the women's group of the traditional women of the traditional fishing union there. And so we chose this as our project study site. In mid-December last year, there were over 66,000 reported cases of COVID-19 in central Java. And this was likely an underestimate. And we also knew that women are often the primary caregivers and frontline health and community health workers in this context. So that gave rise to our aim and our research questions, which were to better understand to what extent and how the COVID-19 pandemic has impacted women's access to WASH in Tambak Lorok Kampung, or village. And this is to assist WASH stakeholders to promote health and social and political equity. The methods we used for our data collection were, we started with a desktop media analysis, and then we did participatory visual data collection and interviews with 24 female residents from Tambak Lorok. So we invited women from this coastal fishing union, or the women's group from this coastal fishing union, to draw or send in photographs of their experience of COVID-19 and WASH. And then we interviewed them over the phone. And we also conducted interviews with representatives of the health planning and water agencies and operators in Tambak Lorok and Semarang City.
Okay, let's take a look at the WASH situation there in Tambak Lorok. We drew a map about that. What you have on the screen, a map regarding the condition of the WASH. There are five neighborhoods, we call it RW. There are only one neighborhood with pipe water infrastructure. And there are a small amount of residents relying on water pipe subscriber due to water affordability. And three or five neighborhoods are having really bad water quality, and they need to put a Nike in water storage, do water treatment, and buy water bottles or gallons for drinking. And also their situation about open defecation in five neighborhoods. I don't know, in color, cream color or cream color here, as you can see on your screen, is the area of coastal flooding in five neighborhoods that they're facing coastal flooding in their daily life. And the picture on your screen is describing about the water quality at Tambak Lorok. That comes from artesian well, where people 99% of their residents relying on artesian wells from provided by water entrepreneurs. And 62% of the participant household water gallons for drinking. It depends on their income. If their income is higher, then they usually buying a higher quality of water than other available sources. This is what we discussed earlier on the screen. As you can see, the sample of the artesian water from artesian well and water from pipe water. And also this is two of the many interviews we had in Tambaloro related to water quality, where people sharing one of the resident Dorma, she shared that water quality is unpleasant and they should make tea or coffee to dilute the unpleasant taste of artesian well. And also Leah sharing about the bad quality of artesian well, so they should do water treatment for the night before using it as a bathing or drinking water. And how the impact of the bad quality of water making them really what it called feeling grateful when they receive water bottle from meeting. The next slide about access to sanitation, where people mostly with private toilets, but only 50% of them having a septic tank, and there are no waste management, so it goes directly to the river. And on the right side of the slide, as you can see, this is the newly built public toilets funded by the German NGO, international NGO. Due to the coastal flooding that we shared earlier, there are difficulties to clean private toilets in a daily basis. So as you can see on your screen, there are women using bottle crate to access to their private toilets. So as you can see, like very dark and muddy water, and it's impossible to clean it in a daily basis. This is the condition of one of the house of our respondent, where that she shared about how poo goes to the river and then back to the sea and then goes to their area because of the coastal flooding. Right, during the pandemic, there is a improved access to hygiene because many people or many residents, they doing self-help, building or installing new hand washing facilities in front of their houses, and they see it as the cheapest way to keeping their family from COVID-19. Right. All of these things, the pandemic giving extra burden on women. Well, as Naomi mentioned earlier, that in traditional family in Indonesia, women become primary caregivers, and during the pandemic it adding extra burden on women. Before the pandemic, 25% of women residents were responsible for housework, and then because of lockdowns and also work from home has adding more housework to women, such as homeschooling, keeping children at home, washing, clothing, and also because of the women, being the main agent of the community works. So they are also being part of the so the community works also adding more burden into women. We cited one of our interview with Norma. This is of course not a real name. She said that during the pandemic, there are no sharing housework with his husband, even he's at work. He's at home, and that also because of the strong mindset of traditional family in Indonesia that women should do all the care should be the primary caretakers in the family. Okay, thank you. Naomi, do you want to add anything?
Just going to say we've got many more findings to share with you, but we've come to time, so we welcome any questions. And thank you for listening.
Thank you.
Yeah, thank you again, Naomi and Wigke, for that great presentation. Now again, questions are welcome, and Bob will be helping in facilitating the question and response part.
I actually had a question. With the lockdown and certainly loss of income into the family, did you see in your research a lack or reduction in the purchase of water, since you mentioned that 62% of water is purchased for higher quality standards?
Let me bring them in. Which names are they using here?
Okay, which name are you using in your participant code? It's not coming up on our screen.
Okay, good. Okay, we are soon having him. Yeah.
The first slide need to be appeared here.
Hello?
I can hear, yeah.
Okay, good. So I had the question from Bob.
Yes, my question is, as part of your study, did you learn anything regarding with COVID and lockdowns and certainly loss of income? Was the percentage of purchased water reduced from the 62%? Were people struggling to purchase water?
Yeah. I think we still don't have the presenter.
Yeah.
Yes, how can I start this presentation?
No. Okay, we shall come back to the questions, maybe from the presenters, because we still can't identify them here. So in the meantime, we are going to go to the third presentation, which is going to be on the impact of COVID-19 on women's access to water, sanitation, and hygiene in an Indonesian village.
Dear guests and participants, warm regards and welcome to our presentation, Response and Resilience in our Rural Bangladesh in the Context of COVID-19. My name is Riad Imam Mahmud, and I'm working as the Country Director of Max Foundation in Bangladesh. And I would also like to introduce my co-authors, Mr. Oidul Islam Kajol, working with me as Senior Program Manager in Max Foundation, and Marco van Krupp. She is working as epidemiologist in the world-famous KIT Royal Tropical Institute. The year 2020 is marked by the COVID-19 pandemic. The first cases in Bangladesh were reported on March 8th. The government declared a nationwide holiday, we call it lockdown, from 23rd March until 3rd May 2020. This impacted the regular program activities in the field, as did Cyclone Amphan, which hit our program area amidst the lockdown. This COVID effect of increased stunting is also reported by global and Bangladesh studies, setting back the stunting progress in Bangladesh by a decade. Max Foundation is working for children in Bangladesh since 2005. And from our learning, we developed healthy village approach to make sure that every children in a village gets a healthy start in life. We focus on nutrition, wash, and mother and child health care. We mobilize, basically what we do, we mobilize parents, communities, government, and entrepreneurs to create a healthy environment for children growth by encouraging the people to improve in some key factors in the community. If a village meets and maintains certain key healthy indicators for wash, nutrition, and mother and child health care criteria for 1 year continuously, it is officially declared a healthy village by the local government. Max Foundation reacted quickly with a COVID response mobile-based campaign launched in April 2020 with COVID safety and wash nutrition messages to the beneficiaries. We reached 80% of the target population with the campaign, and it is around 800,000 people and rest we faced face-to-face, keeping social distancing. And what we found, it is interesting. The mobile-based campaign was very effective, and we'll continue combining in-person and digital outreach in future. This study assesses the impact of COVID-19 on the ability of households to maintain livelihood, households' food security and nutrition of young children, access to water and sanitation, and utilization of health care for the children and their mother. We learned 4 lessons from this study. The first one is severe impact on income and food security, particularly among poor households and in the communities. And we observed significant reduction in household income and consequently reduction in food consumption among adult and children. That is quite significant. And another is interesting observation we found, that increased awareness of hand washing and sanitation, no evidence of increased frequency of diarrhea, indicative of poor hygiene or sanitation. So that's quite interesting. We observed some entrepreneurs like HPA micro entrepreneurs who sell hygiene products the pit emptier who cleans the pit have increased turnover, but the sales in latrine producer, particularly we call it LE, is decreasing in 2020. So entrepreneurs got support from local government for continuing doorstep supply and maintain safety measure. This blue line, you see this top one, the blue line in this graph, micro entrepreneurs annual turnover grew by 73% because they're selling products like soap, hygiene material, mask, etc. So this is a kind of a very interesting observation that we found. We also learned having a ready-to-use database is a strong tool for combating pandemic like COVID-19. We could start mobile messaging immediately using available phone numbers in our call center. By mobile-based messaging, we could reach 80% household, and the rest reached by visiting doorstep and by using rickshaw food loudspeaker. But whatever, it is really, really interesting to work with through the mobile-based campaigning. And it's very every step's COVID safety rule was strictly followed. In this Healthy Village program, we targeted 1,600 villages to work with. And among those villages, 123 is already officially declared as Healthy Village. Now, during this pandemic situation, we see that is a 6% reduction in stunting in the declared healthy villages. On the other side, we saw an increase in the stunting among those children. You see that is increased from 37.4% to 49.6%. Out of these 40,000 children, it looked that almost half of these children are stunted now in the program area. In recommendation, we'd like to emphasize integration of disaster risk reduction activities along with COVID response in South Coastal area, particularly where we saw Amphan had a big impact. So COVID is not solely a public health crisis, but it is an economic one as well. So proper attention is necessary to offset negative consequences of preventive measure like lockdown. And for example, during lockdown, a huge food crisis we observed, and also financial crisis, the people who lost their job. So this food aid and financial aid for poor and vulnerable household also need to combine with COVID prevention activities. This is the end slide. And before ending, I would like to thank and acknowledge the contributors, donors, and partner of Max Healthy Village program, especially the Embassy of Kingdom of the Netherlands, Ministry of Local Government, Ministry of Family and Ministry of Health and Family Welfare, Community Clinic Trust, the Water Board, and the Blue Gold Project, and our colleague Mr. Jamal, Mr. Irfan, and the all field-based officials, participants, and of course the community leaders and community peoples in the program. Thank you very much, and thank you very much for listening to the presentation. Now we are open to hear from you, your queries and suggestions. Thank you.
Thank you, Riad.
Bob, could you take over? There's some noise here in the background, and I wouldn't want to interrupt. So you can moderate the session.
Okay. Are there any questions? Riad, we have brought you into the room. Thank you for your presentation. So we have a question from Sidai. How long did it take to see the improvement in nutritional status from WASH intervention?
Yeah, this is exactly quite long period it takes. Particularly, we are working for last 9 years in this area, and the nutrition intervention we started 5 years ago. So that goes a kind of a behavioral change, and it takes some span of people's mindset changing, and also behavior with nutritional indicator, nutritional products like food diversity, breastfeeding, and other essential nutritional indicators. On the other hand, it also relates with the wash and other hygienic practices. But the program basically combines these two. So the technique is there that it needs to be combined and integrated. So one, people who have a child, and if want to show that the nutrition is working, then they also need to show that they have a better hygiene. So it takes a little bit longer time. It is not a very short-term procedure.
Thank you.
Thank you very much.
Okay, maybe I could also ask one Imam. Like in terms of monitoring, in terms of like looking at changes over time since COVID started, up the current situation, how the rural communities are modifying, also to the different fears, I mean, that come with COVID itself, but also being able to adjust the new livelihoods. What have you seen are the experiences in terms of the resilience, in terms of the coping mechanisms, and maybe, but also in terms of their total modification of their livelihoods to fit into the demands of COVID?
Yeah, very nice question. It is quite complex situation. You know that in this COVID situation, a lot of people returned village from the cities because of losing jobs. So they lost a job, and it's quite significant in number. At least 30% population suddenly back to the communities and start residing. Then it also increased the impact pressure on the local resources, local food chain, and also local income systems. That means it's a kind of new challenge that never seen. Number two is that the once people have lower income, or even in some cases they don't have an income in first few months, then they start coping with in a different way, finding new or different kind of job, different kind of occupation. On the other hand, they also start less expenditure. That means they take less food, they buy less commodities or consumer products. On the other hand, they also lose some psychosocial standard. And we can say it is a shock. So that means while we are now, COVID is much reduced in this week in Bangladesh, but of course it need to be sure that a shock recovery measure also added at the end of the program or to continue the program. So we are also doing this. On the other hand, one important issue that coping mechanism is a kind of a challenge without the government support. Government provided some support, but still there is a big challenge, particularly the children and women, pregnant women, they are really suffered a lot. Thank you.
And we have a follow-up question from Sidai. How sustainable is the healthy village once achieved its status?
Yeah, thank you. The sustainability that we built in a healthy village is based on the entrepreneurs and local government. It is a joint effort because we are NGO and the CSOs are there. So we'll be withdrawing. We are already almost withdrawing. So batch by batch, it is handed over a kind of entrepreneurship developed in the community. So a supply and awareness is related to the entrepreneurs that they supply the local product and also the other necessary products in terms of wash, nutrition, and hygiene. but they do the awareness. So it's a kind of business by awareness they do. So it will be continued. On the other hand, the hardcore poor people and the vulnerable people, they are taken in the charter of the local government service systems. So that is a kind of voice and rights based issue raised, so that if there is anything happens or any sign of stepping down or slippage, then a measure can be taken. On the other hand, we also set a data based monitoring system. We call it Healthy Village Tracker, which is a kind of self propelled, that if even there is no NGO, still the database will work by the local data process from the entrepreneurs. The entrepreneurs, every time they are doing awareness, and they have to put only the data, how many people they reached today and how many, what kind of awareness they did or what kind of messages they did, they thrown today. And this total cumulative figure goes to the Union Parishad. So Union Parishad can observe, that is local government can observe what is happening in their communities. At the end, they also continue a kind of annual monitoring, because when they declared the healthy village, they did a monitoring based on 9 indicators. So each year they will review this indicator, whether these are sustaining or not. If it don't sustain, then they will take a measure that why it is not sustained and what kind of support is necessary from the local government. So that's how the mechanism will work. And it don't need a further support from our side.
Thank you very much again, Imam. So an apology, we don't have live presentation on the second presentation we had from Wigke. So in that perspective, we are again going to have reflections on our two main presentations we have had for where we have our presenters here. And if you have any questions again to both of them, this is the time you can share your perspectives and comments. Okay, so we are just told that Wigke is trying to log in, and yeah, anytime again they log in, we shall also give them an opportunity and respond comments that we got initially regarding their presentation. So just let us know when you're able to make it so that we can have an opportunity to hear from you. Bob?
Okay.
So maybe in the meantime, we are going to have Naomi, who also co-authored the paper, and she's around.
Naomi. We have a question from Rod. Naomi, yep. How easy was the messaging with the communities you were dealing with about the pandemic and potential impacts on health?
This is a great question. Can you hear me okay?
Yes.
From your end?
Yes.
I should preface by saying that Vicar Capri, who is desperately trying to log in but can't at the moment from Indonesia, she coordinated the field work and the data collection, and she's closest to the women who were the subject of the research. So obviously she's best placed to answer these questions, but I will do my best. In terms of the messaging, so our research paper wasn't an action research piece. It was looking at the impacts of COVID-19 on
on the women in this fishing village in called Tambak Lorok in central Java. And we were trying to capture the impacts of the government's messaging. And they tried, they took a multi-pronged approach to the health messaging. They used social media. They drove around in vans, broadcasting health messaging from loudspeakers as well. And they disseminated information through, say, the local markets and in the local village as well. I can't comment on how easy or difficult that was, though. And we didn't, I'm not sure that we asked a particular question around that from the perspective of the government. We were mostly focused on the experiences of the women in the villages. But it's a great question.
Naomi, one question that I had was regarding water access. And I believe it was referenced that 99% of the water is coming from wells.
Yeah.
And about 62% is being purchased. And I'm just wondering, with the economic impact of COVID, was there a reduction certainly in available funds in the household to be purchasing water? And is that going to be looked at from a health risk standpoint?
Yeah, absolutely. So several of the participants reported having to, so, I mean, obviously that 90-60% doesn't add up perfectly. So the 60% were buying water, and that's mostly for drinking water purposes, and then 90% of water use for all other purposes, like bathing and washing clothes and cleaning and washing hands and so on, was coming from the artesian wells. Several participants reported having to stop buying the drinking water and reverting to using the artesian well water and treating it, because of income losses during COVID-19. And that has obvious health impacts, depending on whether people are able to treat it or not.
A quick one to Surendra. So you did share great lessons from the monitoring perspective on COVID. I'm interested in knowing, like, so these trends in the changes in monitoring or the information that is coming in to influence, like, the next steps in adjusting to modifications or to people living their lives in the COVID perspective. So, like, what kind of can you tell us the quick insights about the changes in terms of the attributes you're monitoring?
Oh, yes. It's a great question. In fact, it's not only looking the monitoring side of it, but also the whole programmatic side. Because, yes, the monitoring, we know this is is done to improve the program, to enhance the program quality. And the way that we like collect information, compile it, analyze it, and share with the partners, the partner definitely would use this monitoring data in terms of informing their programs. For example, if there are like evidences coming, so many number of people have received IPC, let's say infection prevention and control measures or supplies in that particular geographical area and by this particular partner, right? Because all the partners come together and use the same monitoring template. And it at national level, it becomes a tool to analyze and see if there are any gaps in any particular area and where the resources are to be prioritized. And it also helps the donors to allocate the resources where the gaps are, where there are less partners and the needs are higher. So this is how we use this information as a kind of informing programming to the partners, including donors and the government. So this is how it is being done. and well appreciated by the donors. And to be specific with you all, whenever we develop proposal for the donors, and internally UNICEF internally, and also with other partners of UNICEF, we have recommended, and the donors are also requesting us to refer to that particular seat. And this is how it is being done. So maybe it is still a good tool for informing programming. It's not only for monitoring that that I can respond now. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Bob.
Are there any other questions?
Yes, there's a question from Rod to Naomi.
We covered that.
Oh, okay.
Yep.
Okay. So, any other questions? Our presenters are ready to respond. Okay, so maybe each of you, as we come to the end, can just give us insights. We are all having all these initiatives towards the sustainable development goals, and we have this sustainable development goal agenda 2030, which again has come in with a mix of COVID-19. So, like, in terms of like simple statements, how do you see us moving forward in achieving the SDGs from our respective kind of small contributions, bearing COVID-19 adjustments in mind?
May I?
Please.
Just want to, okay. See, The context of COVID, in fact, we all know that how it has impacted the direction. Each of the states are like moving forward, and how it has impacted on the whole path. We all are aware about it. But it has also created opportunities. It has been discussed in the sector, especially in the WAS sector, where there are a lot of opportunities. And the respective member states, the respective countries are allocating resources, doing research, and also developing the human resource and creating community momentum towards achieving the goal for SDG 6, to be very specific. But there is a big concern about the financing, whether the financing would be adequate to meet especially the need of safely managed water and safely managed sanitation SDG context. But in terms of hygiene thing, it has come very, very true. But it is not only hygiene that has been discussed or that is being addressed in this COVID times, right? At the same time, we are talking about this safely managed water supply, the importance of safely managed water supply, and the importance of safely managed sanitation, so that we can achieve the hygiene goal, and also we can be ready to respond to any uncertainties like COVID in the future. So I see from my personal, very, very personal point of view that it has created opportunity for the countries and the professionals to be ready and to take extra challenge to achieve SDG. So okay. It is not frustrating, rather it is like optimistic, very honest.
Thanks, Surendra. So yeah. Those are good insights. Imam?
Yes, I think this is very important that we
also
learn.
Also, summary since you're coming to an end.
A kind of great learning for us, particularly who are working in water and nutrition sector, that is we face multi-pronged challenges, and also, of course, it's a big opportunity for learning and also to prepare for future, that how to fight against this kind of disaster, this kind of pandemic, and also how to sustain the community in such situation. And also important that safety measure, that is increasing the savings, and also it's a kind of that people can lose job, people may not have food, so increasing the food storage, increasing the savings, that also become quite an important issue now to face this kind of disaster or pandemic.
Thanks, so that is what,
thank you very much.
Yeah, Naomi, what did you call us?
Fine, I can't even remember what the original question was specifically, but I think the two main, in relation to the SDGs and the pandemic, I think the two main points that came out of our research was, one, how much the pandemic has highlighted the interrelation of all the SDGs. And so the women were facing economic issues, gender inequity issues, WASH issues, health issues. Like they're all, it highlighted all of that in the face of the pandemic, showing that the SDGs are all important, they're all connected. And the second point was that, yes, the COVID-19 pandemic had a massive impact on their lives, but it still wasn't as big as the impact of the tidal flooding that already existed in their villages prior to the pandemic. And I think that highlights the inequity of the pandemic around the world. For people like me in Australia, the pandemic has changed our lives dramatically, but for these women in this village, it was a relatively smaller change. And I think that's an important thing to remember in the context of the SDGs. I'll stop there because I know we're over time.
All right, thank you very much to our three presenters. A great hand clap for you guys.
Thank you.
Thank you all.
Yeah, we wish you a good afternoon and continue enjoying the sessions. Also, great thanks to all our attendees in this session. So please always take time to look at the notes board, to take time to look at all the other events that are taking place during this session period.